We are now. I bring a student from Cornell to do a field trip about winter urbanism and how people in Montreal is practicing their life in the winter with snow. And so we are learning a lot. About Montreal now, and all this investigation is based on this idea of behaviorology, and this is the book. It's also the title of our book, published in 2011, and in this book we investigate. We discuss three different behavior in the building or around the building. So anyway, designing architecture is dealing with these three behaviors. And the first one is natural behaviors, such as light and heat and water and wind, humidity. They all behave based on their nature. Based on the physical disciplines. So we don't really change this discipline. So always water run from above to bottom because of the gravity. And the warm, the air, heated warm, heated air goes up. And when the steam touch to the very cold surface, it's condensate there. So this is all very micro, small, natural phenomena happening inside of the building, around the building, and so they are not they yeah. For example, condensation in the room is somehow very problematic for human beings, but the humidity and heat and the air, they are not guilty. And it's human beings who just don't know the behavior of them. So then second behavior is human. Of course, we behave, but it's more in a capricious way. And we can't really predict the behavior of human beings. But in a certain condition, people behave in a certain way because behavior is not totally individual. It is shared among people. And this is a very important point to address behavior through architecture, because architecture is not something which really fits to certain individuals. And it's not good at dealing with one single individual, but it is much better to deal with good at better at dealing with shared things. And so I think behavior is it's a point of view, probably maybe 30 meters away from each individuals. And then you can, so from here your behaviors are almost same, so you share the same behavior just sitting on the seat and watching me and the screens. And and this relationship, one person is talking to the many people, and this is understood as collective behavior of the people, so you can keep it. And so, okay, third one is building behavior. It sounds strange because the building doesn't move. It's fixed, it's solid, it's hard, so it's not life itself. But if you take 100 years of time scale, you can observe the transformation of the city by replacing old building into new one, or the transforming of old building into new condition. And we can say this is also behavior of the building. And from this point of view, I realize that, okay, behavior is all totally up to the time scale. And same thing can happen in the natural behavior. For example, typhoon, you can't observe in 3 hours, you should wait for a week. No, 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 a year, not 1 week. So every summer, we in Eastern Asia country, we are hit by typhoon. And this is a huge macro scale phenomena of nature. It's not produced by architecture, but anyway, architecture should deal with typhoon in certain region. But the raise increase of the temperature in the room in the morning, in the room facing to the west, to the east. If the sun is coming in the room, the temperature can go higher, like three degree higher from 9 o'clock to noon. So you can observe this behavior of the heat or air in 3 hours. And there are also the synchronicity between different type of behaviors. So this is an image of Hanami. Hanami is a kind of celebration of cherry blossom in spring, especially in Japan. And so cherry blossoming is annual behavior of cherry. And it has certain reason. And people are waiting for this moment. And it's a signal of the spring. So when cherry is blossoming, people go out from the house and start eating and drinking. It's the most interesting moment to visit Tokyo or Japan because people are so happy and cheerful and open-minded. And they behave sometimes badly by drinking too much under the cherry blossom. And so this is interesting synchronicity. And I think this is not architecture, but somehow architecture is doing very similar things to make a kind of synchronicity or integration between two, three, four different behaviors at one entity. And I think this is the power of architecture. And this is another example I can observe. Yeah, I like to show how I see this streetscape. This is Nørrebrogade in Copenhagen in summer, and but late summer. So it's early in the evening. It's not so warm, and so you see the people. Some people are wearing already long sleeve shirts on riding bike. And many people are sitting on the sidewalk, touching the stone balustrade by their back, and this is a very they are enjoying the stored heat on the stone balustrade. And from the sun, and enjoying the last moment of the daytime. And this sidewalk of this bridge was enlarged last year or the day 2 years ago. And then suddenly it is occupied by people to spend time and drink and sing. And so it becomes a very interesting new gathering space. But here there are so many behaviors, like heat behavior in the stone balustrade, and sitting behavior of the people on feeling the warmth from the stone balustrade, and the pedestrians, pedestrians and the bike passing in front of it. They also enjoy this movement in different speed, And the most interesting thing is this northern side of the balustrade sidewalk is always packed by full of people, a lot of people. But the another side, the southern side, is there are no people because it's always in the shadow. So the balustrade is not so warm. So people choose the place by people naturally find a place to sit down, and on finding the on yeah on yeah they found the, this heat is the warmth stored in the stone bracelet and to define the behavior. This is very this is also it's not architecture but it's also very important to think about public space. And this is another behavior in China, Tiandan Park, at 6 a.m. in the very early in the morning. Tiandan Park is very interesting park. It's occupied by so many trees in the extremely regular grid. And you can see 300 years tree and 30 years tree, 10 years tree, in it's as a kind of simple repetition because they just replace old trees which is almost dying by new tree in the same format. So and it's this repetition of a tree creates three interesting perspectives, one in front of you and second is your both side. It's and then lateral side. So this three different perspective is a kind of stage of Tiandan Park, and you see the people, you see the guy practicing Tai Chi 100 meters away from your position, and each of them have their own way to exercise, way of exercise, so. The this left top, they are enjoying the lifting feather. How do you call this shuttle? Yeah, and the second one is they are enjoying social dancing, and the third one she's massaging her shoulder, and with a strange protrusion from the very old tree. So this is a kind of interesting meeting point between different rhythm of the life. One is the life of a tree, which is already 300 years old with this strange protrusion. But this protrusion fit very well her shoulder, and she's doing like this. And this is also very subtle behavior, but it's also as a way to participate into public space. And Tai Chi and sword dancing. So this variety of exercise really activate and animate this park as public space. So public space is somehow very, it is not just open space, open accessible space for everybody, but it's important to trigger some sense of practice of public space by our bodies. And I believe every human beings has this sense of this ability to participate into that kind of space. So we did one project, from here. Yeah, I like to show one project related to this investigation on the public space. This is a BMW Guggenheim lab. This is a model, and we are asked by BMW Guggenheim to design the traveling pavilion to establish the urban think tank in different cities, started from New York and then Berlin and Mumbai. So the scenario is to create a kind of open discussion in the city, on the place, with local people and specialists and from different disciplines. And through reading the requirements and the document from we received from Guggenheim, we realize that it's something like a very open and generous space. So I imagine this type of loggia space, This is a city loggia I found in Opatija in Croatia. It is built at the gate of the mountain city. It's beautiful. You can see, you can watch the beautiful landscape. But this building is vacant, empty. You can use it for a funeral, wedding, for market, for judgment, for daily gathering, and you can be alone when there are no one. And so this type of generous space is it's very necessary today, I think, for public space. So on borrowing this framework of BMW Guggenheim Lab, we try to make this type of very open, generous space like loggia. And the requirements set, through the requirement, we understood that they need, the pavilion needed 500 square meter. But the actual site finally we selected with BMW and Guggenheim was this type of interstitial space in lower east side of the New York. It has only 175 square meter, and but the concept of Guggenheim, BMW Guggenheim Lab, was to open in each city in the best season, like June in New York, or like July, August in Berlin, or December in Mumbai. So in with this concept, the pavilion doesn't need any air conditioning. And we didn't want to make the pavilion 2 stories and 3 stories high, because it once you start doing this, you have to deal with universal design and body design, and you have to make elevator and slopes and etc. And then it is not so a clever way to make a temporal structure. And so in each place, it stays 6 weeks or 10 weeks, so it's not so long. And the main problem is the shortage of the surface of the ground. So I propose them to shift the idea from exhibition space. So through the document, we found that they try to think this Guggenheim Lab as a kind of alternative exhibition space. But I found it's better to think this as a traveling theater. And then we propose to cut the stage and the fly loft of the theater and insert it into the city. And then so this is a model we proposed. So it's a fly loft. It is called Toolbox. So it has it contains lighting and screens and furniture storage, and many things are suspended, and you can pull them down to change the mode on the ground level. So ground level is basically totally empty, but you can create a different setting by putting different instruments down on the ground. And we made this structure by CFRP, carbon fiber reinforced plastic, which is extremely light and strong. And based on this idea, the theater idea, Guggenheim had a clear vision, a clear perspective to organize the lab. So they start making the time schedule of every day. And this gives a strong structure to the lab activity. And this is a result. So it's like inserted in the middle, in between buildings. So this is a condition when there is nothing. So you can pass through from Houston Street to the Fast Street. And we have this catwalk on the upper level, which is not accessible for the public. And we can suspend many different things from above. And left is showing the condition of work, of a game called Urbanology, produced by the thinkers invited by Guggenheim. And the right one is showing the moment when people are doing a workshop. This is a lecture mode, and this is a film viewing mode. This is a game. And we moved this structure to Berlin in the campus of Aedes campus in the courtyard. It's a relatively bigger space. So you can also see the building from lateral side. And so we did a different program here. And then we tried to move this structure to Mumbai, but by several reasons, we couldn't ship the carbon fiber structure to Mumbai. And then curator and we decided to change to design or to build a new structure with local material and local laborship, craftsmanship. So it's made, the structure is made by bamboo in this case. So we start tested some different type of joint, learning from the bamboo furniture or Latin furniture. And also we consulted Arab Mumbai to make it the structure enough strong for 10 weeks long installation. And we started this idea with very easy consensus, and because we saw so many temporal bamboo structure in the city, but the most of them are attached to the existing trees and existing building fence, so they are not self-standing, so they are always leaning to something more stable on site. But in the site was a back garden of National one of the museum owned by the government, so we couldn't touch anything, any trees. So the bamboo structure should be self-standing, and this made the project very difficult. But anyway, we found the solution. So this is a model on showing some joints of the bamboo. We try to keep the same idea of having the boxy structure above ground and create a kind of open space on the ground level. But in this case, we can't hang so many things from bamboo structure. So we made another type of lighting and okay, so in this case, structure is not only one. We have a mother love in the back garden of the museum, and traveling love in the different neighborhood. Every week, we brought this I-shape structure into the different neighborhood, because the social segregation in Mumbai is still very strong. So it's not so easy for people living in the poor area to go to the museum zone, cultural zone. So we try to approach them by bringing the structure. And then we found an interesting fabricator in Nagpur, which is three hours away by plane from Mumbai, and so they are very wild. Yes. So they are making, this is, they are doing a cement resin on by hand. And this is electricity plugging. And so so we did also the upper part was cladded by this a series of rope, which reminds a lot the Japanese soba restaurant, and the entrance of a soba restaurant. And since it is traveling love, so it should be pop up on the site in one day. So the structure is prefabricated like that. So you see the lying structure is one of the structural bay, and they are connected by a truss unit, which across the to separate structure unit, and they are tightened each other by wooden blocks and ropes. And this is how it is constructed. And okay, it's man-made. Yeah, we didn't use a machine to make it. Okay, so this is a joint. So
so the column is made of. When it's built, the column is a double column, bundled by ropes and wooden joint. And between two columns, truss beam inserted, and it's also tightened with the columns.
And this is a result in the back garden of the museum. This season there is no rain, so we actually from this rain, in terms of rain, we don't need to have roof, but the sun is very strong, and also there are so many birds in the branches and the tree canopies, and they give us some gift, so we have to. We have to cover the structure by the roof to avoid being hit by this gift. Yes. So this is interior space, and this series of ropes. It doesn't. This is a strategy to avoid to get a wind load for this structure. So we just consider the wind load for the roof. So some the heaviest lighting instruments is fixed on the leaning coconut tree, and okay. So people naturally have rest on the foundation. Yes, and this is a night. Before opening. And this is after the opening. They had many different programs. This one of the program was decoration by flower. And this is traveling love in the park. Sorry, the image is not so clear. So one in the beach. Yeah, it gathered many people, and many women also. Yeah, because one of the thinker run a program about the social status of women in Indian society. And so this is the scene of this event. Okay, and then I like to show something about the houses in Tokyo, which we are designing, which we designed. And before that, I like to show the nature of Tokyo. And this is a view from Observatory of Metropolitan Government in Shinjuku, and on the northern western direction, and you can see the infinitive repetition of small grains of houses until the foot of mountain, and this vast urban texture made of detached house is very unique and dominant structure of the city. So Tokyo is made of houses, not skyscrapers. And why this? Behind this landscape, some reason exists, and this is the graph showing the life average of the house in different countries, and England it's 140 years, and in Japan it's 30 years. It's extremely short, so it means every 30 years the grain of the city is replaced by new one. So this is a kind of metabolism of the city fabric. And in 60s, metabolists long manifested the concept metabolism by designing this type of building, which is structuralized by two different elements. One is the central core, which contains lifelines and circulation of the people. And second element, the replaceable capsule, which is attached on the surface of the core. And I think in that, in 60s, architects believed that the urban creation can happen by the concentration of money and power. So they believed that this type of core could be much bigger than this, and it could be a kind of an architecturalized city or vertical city assisted by a very architectural system. And actually what really happened in the reality after 60s, after 50s, after World War II, is the image on the right side. And this is the aerial view of Setagaya, one of the most populated area of Tokyo. And it is totally occupied by, the surface of the ground is totally covered by tiny, small grains of houses with a lot of gap space between buildings. And this type of city, urban fabric, is constantly regenerating by itself and on holding the void within it. So I may compare two different type of metabolism, understanding of metabolism, the left one with core and the right one with void. And then I start to call this urban fabric void metabolism. And within this void metabolism is somehow the nature of the city of Tokyo, which we can't stop easily. It has its own rhythm, and it's already start running its own life. So because there are 1.8 million landowners in Tokyo, most of the property are owned by private. So it is very difficult to introduce big urban planification on this type of urban fabric. So it is very different from China, for example. In China, most of the property is owned by government, so they can decide the future very quickly. And and within this nature, I think what we can do is to intervene into this nature of the city. And so from this point of view, we are doing urban research, and we found a very interesting phenomena and a very serious phenomena in within this type of residential area, and which is called suburban. Suburban is neology by adding subdivided and suburban. And so this is a new word, suburban. And it can happen in many different places in the world. So first generation of suburban area started from 1920s, are now swallowed in the urbanized area, and people don't think this is a suburban area. It's an urban area, urbanized area. And Okusawa has started its development in 1923, and it is also the moment when new typology of for the people to live, which is a detached house, were introduced in Tokyo. So this map shows how the property are subdivided into small pieces during time. Initially, it has 250 square meter, but nowadays the newly the property which is on the market, newly sold in the market, is 80 square meter. So it became one third of the original size. And the mechanism behind this phenomena can be described by this diagram. It starts from above to bottom. And so the first generation had 250 square meter, but in 80s we experienced a bubble economy, and at that time the price of land increased extremely high, and the inheritance tax was over 50%. So if single if you are the only child and who inherit the property, 250 square meter property from parents, you have to pay a $2 million just to get the 250 square meter property. And so it is not affordable for normal employee. So they were obliged to subdivide the land into small pieces and sold to pay the tax. So this is a simple mechanism which accelerated the subdivision of the land. And it's produced interesting shape of the property. The one is a very narrow one with very small frontage and deep long depths, or square one, which is mostly obtained by the original owners. And the third one is a flagpole site, which has 2 meters frontage to the public street and a bigger space in the backside of the another property. And so this subdivision is quite typical in eastern part of Japan, Tokyo. Yeah? And so in this phenomena, we can easily observe different generation of houses. So it's because the area is already 19 years old, and the life average of the house is 30 years. So simply calculated, if you calculate simply, the area can experience the regeneration of the building twice. So it means we can see first, second, third generation today in the area. Of course, there are differences of the lifespan, depends on each individual family and house building. So we can see many different generations today. And the first generation is like this. In 20s, Japanese people didn't have car, so there is no garage in which abuse the frontage of the property, and it's covered by green hedge. And second generation have garage, and the property became a little bit smaller, but they still have a strong preference to cover the building or their life by green. And the third generation is something like this. The property is bought by developer, and they subdivide land into small pieces and build this type of building and sell. And disappointing type of house. For example, the garage is not deep enough, the people should go inside of the house by stepping down, and in just 1.5 meters space, and they lose the garden, and they lose a quasi exterior space like terrace and engawa. And then the distance building became very close, and then window became very tiny, so we don't know what's happening inside of the house, and there is no way to communicate with inhabitants and people on the street. And it's not the direct reason, but I think behind this type of production of space, we can hear the news, which is very sad today, the single elderly person die alone and discovered 2 months later of his death, for example. And this becomes very crucial, very big issue today for Japanese community, society. And then what we are doing now as architect and designing the house in Tokyo is inevitably designing the fourth generation. Because after 2010, every building, every new house is historically considered as fourth generation based on the statistics of the average lifespan is 30 years. So, okay, then I raise the question, what a fourth generation should be? And then I found the history of the transformation of detached house typology in 20th century was losing generosity of the house in our society. And then fourth generation should bring back this generosity of the house into our life. And so in order to achieve it, I raise three premises for fourth generation. The first is to create a space which is not strange for non-family members. So it means the space where non-family member can be at ease. And for example, cafe, shop, and office, and atelier, any kind of space which is not literally a house. And because one of the strong reason of this kind of subdivision is also was the transformation of the household. So it became the household became more and more nuclear type. And then the house became purely for a nuclear family. So, of course, yes. So even if they are nuclear family, they can also have some space for someone else. So I think this is one premise. And second is providing more opportunity to spend outside of the building, like a veranda, loggia, etc. And the third one is redefining the gap space between building, void space. So now in this photo, the interstitial space, void space between building is dead space. But we know that anyway we produce this type of space by making a house in the densely built area. So this type of space should be considered from the beginning of the designing of the house. So when I like to show one example of fourth generation house, which is a house in Atelier Bawa, where we are living and working. So the site is a flag post site surrounded by buildings. And this is the initial scheme to divide the house into vertical staircase part and a stacking floor part. But the house, in that case, we just put the house in the staircase, but it was very difficult to imagine. So we ended with this scheme. I'm sorry, this is not so clear. Very soft focus. Can you sharpen the focus? So the bottom two floors are the office and the upper two floors are the house. And yes, it's better. It's better. Ah, yeah, it was okay.
And there is an intermediate space between office and house,
which is called living room, but it is actually used for the big meeting and the model shooting and etc. So the house is built in the flag pole site, so you can't see the building from the street. And it's very hidden. And you approach from the light side, yeah, with a strange pavement. And you enter directly to the office. There is only one entrance, so we didn't have two entrances, one for house, one for office. No, we have only one entrance. And it's house and office mingle in the house. This is upper level of the landing. Watching down the office space on the ground level, you can see the dining and kitchen and living room on upper level. And this is a view from dining space. And now the landing, one of the landing is occupied by models, so it becomes a model viewing space. And the left side, this is living room, which is very open to neighbors. And so we have this type of balcony, which is a quasi extra exterior space. We wanted to make it more open to the street, but in this property it was very difficult. So anyway, we made it. But this space really fills all the void space between buildings as part of your space. And we borrow the neighbor's wall as a wallpaper, and so this is a moment when sun is washing the surface of the neighbor's wall on creating many different shadows on it. We go upstairs and then it becomes more woody, and so it becomes more house like this, yeah. Okay, and for another type of property, which is narrow and deep, we are proposing a machia typology. And this is one of the buildings called split machia. And machia is originally developed in western part of Japan, like Kyoto, Kanazawa, and established its typology in Edo period. And it has a very strong characteristic, but it's very similar to many townhouses in England and Netherlands. Many different parts of the planet has its own townhouse, and this is Japanese version. And there are five. We raise five different characteristics. One of the first is it's adjacent to the. Attaching to the neighbor next building, which is very rare in Tokyo, Because Tokyo main, in Tokyo main typology is detached house, and second is it's a narrow and long space with
this long interiorized garden, which is called Toriniwa.
It's a passing through garden, and it's covered, but it's with earthen wall. So it's in between garden and house interior, and also it utilizes the whole frontage with one element to make a better connection with neighbors. So the way to In Kyoto, in Kanazawa, in the past, people knew how to build the house, and then and each individual practice of making of building a house could create a very beautiful, magnificent streetscape and townscape, and it was the most sophisticated moment for Japanese city to deal with house and city together. It was before motorization, and motorization totally destroyed this type of buildings. And we did the research in Kanazawa, how this typology has been transformed during 20 centuries. And so this is first generation, which still keep its own original structure, but gradually some elements is replaced by plastic canopy, and the ground level is totally erased for making parking, and they sometimes they have a mask made of brick tile to pretend a more Western building. It's not Western, but for Japanese this is enough modern and Western. And to enlarge this added eave on the ground level at the first level to invite pedestrians to go into the shop, and some buildings already retired from the street to make a parking, but some of them try to touch again to the street on making a parking. So this is as a series of transformation of Machiya typology, and most of the people in Kanazawa and Kyoto, they don't think this is Machiya type townhouse typology. They believe this first generation is a proper and genuine typology of Machiya. But actually, the intelligence is still remains in these transformation, and I found it's very interesting to encourage people to continue to think about this intelligence of Machiya typology in Kanazawa. And typology is a kind of a package of the intelligence of human beings about spatial organization and the way of living in different places, on reacting to the different weather, climates, culture, and social structure, etc. And I think in Tokyo now we can apply this intelligence of the townhouse again, because the condition is very similar to Machiya, because by the subdivision of the land, the property became very narrow and sometimes deep, sometimes very shallow, but so they can only grow in a vertical way. So left one is called Tower Machiya, and the right one is called Split Machiya. And I think this is it sounds probably strange why you make Machiya in Tokyo. Machiya is originally from Kanazawa and Kyoto and the western part of Japan. But I think its typology is totally open for everybody and any period of time. And if you can find this application or intelligence embedded in typology of Machiya, you can use it. And it's not, it's use, you can use it in a similar condition. And in Tokyo, I use it several in for three buildings already, and I like to show this split machia. So the house is split into two. Even they have only 58 square meter in total. So each, so we built two tiny house which has only 29 square meter each. One is 3 stories high and one is 2 stories high. The one has a kind of concrete foundation on the, as a, the ground level, and it's act as a retaining wall of the garden, which is above a little bit raised up from the street level. And the two houses are connected by big giant bench, which is actually a kind of exterior corridor. And the left house has a kitchen, but no bathroom. And the right house has bathroom but no kitchen. So they have to collaborate each other to create a one complete house. In okay. So we draw this type of sectional perspective always. And so this is the house. So this is a garden. Between two houses, and this is also refer. It's we apply the idea of tsuboniwa. Tsuboniwa is literally, if I literally translate tsuboniwa into English, it is pot garden. So it's like a garden in the pot. So it's a very deep from the roof. And so, but at the bottom there is a small garden in Japanese machia. So, but I think this can also apply in this type in this case. So we made a small garden in the middle of the tiny house to provide more sun and wind in the house. And and yes, so this is a dining space with a staircase finished with copper, which reminds the fire. And behind this wall, there is a kitchen. And so there is also another characteristic of this site penetration in the house in machia typology. So we apply same system by making by positioning the different windows on the same position in a short section. So five windows are working together to create a very long view from inside of the house towards outside. Now you can see the garden from of neighbor. You can see through the building. It's a bit bug, but you can see the house in front of the building. So, yeah, again, this site penetration, like this. And another example of is, it's not in the city, it's a little bit far from, 1 hour from central part of Tokyo. So I met one woman who is going to retire in 5 years, in 2008 or 9, asking me, please design the house for me to live with Pony after my retirement. So, but the budget was extremely small, so I hesitated to work with her. But she was so, she came many times to our office and finally convinced me with very tiny budget, but her scenario was extremely interesting. So I asked her why most of people after retirement wants to travel abroad. But and she said, I have already traveled abroad a lot, so I don't need to travel anymore. And she really wants, she said, I really wants to create a new rhythm of life by living with Pony. And yeah, of course, living with Pony needs you to change your rhythm of your lifestyle. So I said, okay, I really I'm really interested in your scenario. So, but okay, I can do it. I can make your the something for you, but not for you, for pony. So it is tied to the pony garden. And so I said, okay, I can design the garden for pony and with a small shed to maintain the pony. And so there is no glass window, and it's okay. And she said, yes, it's okay. So the house has a huge, the big loggia space on the ground level, which is actually dining and kitchen. So this is a house I found in near Mumbai, I don't remember. When I visited the studio Mumbai, so I walked along the street and found this house, and I was surprised because the old guy is floating in under the roof. And actually, he was sitting on the balance, suspended from the beam, and I found this space is extremely rich because there are so many different type of behavior is coexisting together, wind and light and shadow and the voice of the children of the neighbors, and so he's reading the book, and also some unexpected visitor like me, and I approached him and say hello, and he said hello and continued to read the book. And without paying any attention on me, and so it was so nice. And so this is one of the good example to think about the generosity of the house. And so I really like to introduce this type of spice into Japanese house today. And so this is a plan of I'm sorry, the image is not beautiful. So this is a pony garden. So pony garden is rectangular. It's a primary shape for the property. And then we borrow the corner from the pony to make a small building. And so you can feed the pony from inside of the house and chat. And watch always the pony. And this room is outside with floor heating, so you can also use this room in the winter time. And if it's too cold, you can escape in the attic space, which has air conditioning. And you can, on the right side, there is a glass window, the fixed glass window, and you can watch down the pony. This is a room of a pony. Yeah. Okay. Then, I talked about the house and how a house is main elements of urban structure, and and then what is happening in the suburban area of Tokyo today, like 1 hour and 1.5 hour away by train, is a declining of population. And we did one project in Kitamoto City, which is 1 hour from the central part of Tokyo, to deal with this issue. And this is a station plaza when we arrived at first time to this city. It's totally occupied by asphalt and car traffic. It's just designed for car traffic. Because it is designed in 1970s, it's a second generation of station plaza of this city, and it was a moment when car traffic was the most important thing to consider for any kind of design, any kind of architectural design and urban design. So the car activity were given the first priority from the planning, and it stays until today. But from 90s or in the middle of 90s, most local cities start reconsider the station plaza as space for communication rather than space for traffic. And so this and the genealogy of a station plaza in Japan, I must explain briefly. This is the second generation which deal with the traffic, car traffic. And the third generation is try to deal with pedestrians. So they built the many station built pedestrian deck. They split pedestrians' circulation on the upper level. And but this stays for 50 or 60 years, and it's really damaged the activity on the street level. Street level is just occupied by car, so it's the most important area for part of the city. It's in front of the station, but the ground level is very dead because there is no pedestrians. Pedestrian is always passing through on the upper level. But the Kitamoto city didn't grow quickly. So they missed to build the pedestrian deck in 80s. It was lucky for the city to not to have the opportunity to build it. And then they can easily adapt the new demand for the station plaza, which is addressing now to the communication, to create a kind of space for meeting people, make people meet together. And this is a demographic map of diagram of this city. So the age over 55 until 70 is the majority of the population, and this goes up in they are the population who immigrated into this city in 60s and 70s by the expansion of the suburban development, and it means the making house brought them into the city and produced this type of demographic pattern, because the second generation, they are second generation, 30 to 44, they are the second generation of junior generation of this majority. And but the 20s, they are shrinking, and they don't want to live in this. They won't live in the. They don't want to commute 1.5 hours from this city to Tokyo, so they prefer to stay inside of Tokyo, even in the small apartment building, and they are losing its population now. And this new immigrant in 60s. They don't have a strong connection with local people because their life is basically in Tokyo, especially men. And there are another type of a population, which is not the majority, but the older population, which are farmers. And city mayor is really worrying about this disconnection between two different communities in one city. In the super aged society, so the city asked us to redesign the station plaza to solve this problem, but the commission was very interesting because it's not only redesigning the station plaza, but they also asked us to organize series of workshop in order to activate the commercial street and. To encourage citizens to participate into the town management activity. And so we started have a workshop in front of the station, inviting many children and mothers, asked them to draw the future of the station plaza. And many of them draw trees. And because this city is very famous by its orchid, the woods on the flat area, today it is very limited, but before it was most of part of the city was occupied by, covered by these woods. And this map shows the white part is a newly developed residential area, but the green part is farming and the dark green part is woods. And so they still have woods in the city, so it's a big characteristic. And there are several, there are very interesting NPO group and who maintain these woods, and also city owns some woods to use it as a kind of a public facility. And so we thought it's nice to, it's interesting to bring this tree activity or tree related activity into the station plaza by borrowing the rhythm of the maintenance of woods, which needs to be cut every 20 years to keep same phase of the woods. And so it, because now and until before this project started, the station plaza, the rhythm of the station plaza is totally dependent on the rhythm of Tokyo. So only in the morning and evening there are so many passengers, but in the daytime, in nighttime, there are no one in the plaza, and there are no cafe, and it's a very sad place. And cities, people living in this city doesn't like, doesn't have a strong identity to their hometown. So it's because of the rhythm is totally dependent on the Tokyo. So we thought it's important to bring different type of rhythm into this station plaza. And one proposal is this tree maintenance. And another proposal is to open the cafe or market, etc. So we did many social experimentation on the existing station plaza. This is one trial to open the market, inviting many shop owners and ask people how they feel. And it was very positively received by people. And because we thought it's very nice to bring freshly cropped vegetables in the same city to sell in front of the market. And we also provide some very simple furniture to sit, because there are no bench in the station plaza today. We also examined this kind of universal design. We wear the gips to walk as a kind of disabled people. And we also made an experimentation of the street pattern, which is not entire, but we recreated this corner, which is the most crucial part in our design, and inviting bus and taxis and general car to drive if they, this shape produce any traffic jam or not. Yes. And then this is a result. This is a rendering to show how we produce a kind of open public space in front of the station by reducing the asphalt. It becomes a triangle shape. And we give also three different roof, 80 meters with 6 meters high, and 50 meter and 6 meters long with 4.5 meters high. And one side is bus, one side is taxi, and one side is a family car. So there are three different car in this plaza. So we consider different behavior of these different cars, giving the different angle of the station plaza. And this park, open plaza part, is the most important part with trees and with program, with content. So it shouldn't be just empty space. So we By organizing the workshop, we start to discover the human resources in the city. And we found so many different people who has different skills and who can really practice, who could practice their own public space. And this is a Machizukuri caravan, town management caravan. We rent one vacant, empty shop with very low rent and organize a workshop every month, twice a month. And so from street, you can clearly see the, what is happening inside. So we invite many different people. farmers and shop owners of Japanese sweets and professors of university professors and high school students and of course people from the city administration and cafe owner, etc., etc. And now what they are doing is making an annual calendar how to utilize this plaza. And everybody proposes something and everybody discuss how to practice this in the reality. And every time after the meeting, a student of Momoyo, my partner, who is a student of Tsukuba University, they draw this type of drawing, just fixing the activity of the place. Of the features occurred in the discussion. And the next meeting we show it and discuss again. This is showing the winter festival. So there are some decoration, lighting decoration for Christmas trees and also a series of small Christmas trees brought from different families. So we also start using this plaza. Even the roof is not completed. And like this, and this is a result of the construction, but we are still working on this workshop and connecting people and creating a social network. It's a kind of not physical construction but a social construction on it's a kind of a collaborative work. It's not a labor division. It's a labor collection and a skill collection. And we construct some social, we construct some social structure by using different skills from different peoples. And so for example, yeah, but this is nice image that the roof gives a shadow on the sidewalk, and every morning, the three old guys sitting on the bench, they come to this bench and chat for 3 hours. So this is not the place to park the bicycle, but the two of them always come by bike, and one come by walk. So they are sitting always in this bench, on watching the park. So there is an interesting intersection of two different roofs over the street. It's really make a speed car speed slow at the mouth of the station plaza. So it's like this. So visually, you feel like you can't drive anymore. But actually, you can go a little bit by turning to right. Yeah, the structure is mimicking the system of the trees, but it's not just a shape. It's really structurally generated in different form by different position of column and the roof. They are all different. So this is a scene of a market happening on the plaza. Yes. Okay, and okay, I have to skip this probably. No time to this. What time is it? Maybe I skip this. So the last one. I like to show some what we are doing for the recovery project in Tohoku area in the framework of ArchiAid. And ArchiAid is a network of volunteer network of architects working for recovery project in Tohoku area. And after tsunami, after a big earthquake in 2011. And this, we are especially working on one peninsula. 15 different schools directed, driven by different architects in my generation, working in this peninsula on visiting different fishermen's village, which was totally damaged by tsunami. But the degree of damage are very varied. For example, the upper one, Yorisohama, it's 58% of the houses are destroyed, but the second one in Yagawahama, 100% destroyed, and Niyamahama, there is no building destroyed. It depends on the topography and the shape of the bay. And so we are, after 3 months of, 4 months of tsunami, a big earthquake, the inhabitants, the village people are still living, still staying in the, they just moved into the temporary housing at that moment. And then we visited each villages to hear the voice of the fishermen, the voice of the village people, what was their life before the earthquake and what they want to do in the future. And we also make this kind of map to describe the characteristic of each village. We made 28, we made this type of research in 28 beach villages with as a 15 laboratories, you know, from different schools. For example, one of the main operations from the government is to establish a new residential area on the upper level of the village, and move all the people who lost the house in this area. And the city commissioned with a civil engineering consultant, and they didn't have time to visit to hear the voice and to the people. They just draw the plans on the map, and it's very rough. And so we make a kind of not a counter project, but a kind of a suggestive proposal scheme, another alternative study, or to make a new residential area on the upper level of the village. This is the right side, on using the natural topography and try to avoid to cut the mountain as small as possible. And and we also draw the comprehensive plan of the future of the village, including this new residential area and the port and the fish industry and the schools and et cetera, et cetera. So it's all necessary for people. But the menu provided from the government is very segregated by the ministry, this bureaucracy. So construction and the transport ministry just operating the move of a residential area from bottom to top. And fish industry ministry is providing they are operating the recovery project of the port area. And prefectural government is planning to raise the street level higher. And city and prefectural government also try to make a dike, new dike, which is twice or three times bigger than before the earthquake. So there are so many different projects are thrown into small villages, but there is no one who watch everything. So we draw everything by listening from village people, from city administrative, prefectural administrative people, and make a comprehensive drawing like this. And discuss with people. And in the discussion, we confronted the big problem of the depopulation of the village. At first, most of the people who lost the house wanted to come back to the village, but after half years and after another half years, this number of people who wants to come back decrease because the process is too slow. So they were very much discouraged to go back to the village, because the government says, oh, it takes 4 years to go back to your hometown. And if you are 65, you will be 69. And then from 69, it is very difficult to make your new house by your money. And so all these things really discourage people to go back to the community. And it's really risk the sustainability of the community. So we try to encourage people to provide a very cheap but small house and affordable house, which really adapting to the lifestyle of the fishermen. So we proposed this house called Core House. Core House is initially proposed by Professor Ikaptora in Indonesia after big earthquake in 2008. And the idea is start building tiny core, the most essential part of the house, and grow it and make it grow in the future by recovering their life and their business. And in order to design this core, we refer to, the graphic is not clear, but this is a typical plan typology of fisherman's house in the area. So there is always a kitchen here, and a small living room for family. And this is, and Zashiki is a more formal living room, and this is a sleeping room. So we just took first two parts as a core, including a bathroom inside, and add eave space, lodger space in front of it to have an entrance and also quasi-exterior space for fishermen to repair their fishing net, for example. So this is a plan, and it's built by the very traditional Japanese construction technique called Itakura, means wooden warehouse. The system is like this. At first, we build the columns with slit, and we insert the panel, which is prefabricated in the factory, into between two columns, and it gives enough strength against the earthquake. So this is the column and beam could be also pre-cut in the factory, and the panel is prefabricated in the factory. So we can build this house in 2 days, almost. So of course it took we need electricity, plumbing, and windows, etc. So it takes 1.5 months, but the main part could be built in 2 days. So, and we also propose how the house can expand without any big change of the original core house, and and we also show expected the landscape of our new fisherman's village, which has less population than before, but more larger space, which you can see the neighbors on walking. And we decided to make a model house because we have to really find a solution to reduce the cost. And also, we want fishermen to see this house in the reality and touch and smell. And it is built 100% Japanese cedar. And which is originally very local materials. But nowadays, yeah, in the fisherman's village, they build their own house from the trees, with the trees from the mountain, their mountain. They own also the mountain. They are fishermen and farmers, but same time forest owner. So, and they are sometimes carpenter, and they are sometimes cook, and so they are very attractive people. And so, yes, so it's built like this. So in order to build this house, model house, we ask this temple monk to lend the property. So we built the on the property of the temple, and we gave this model house to the temple. And then in Japanese law, temple doesn't need to pay tax, so we don't need to pay tax for this. But we can also run this building as a model house for the people. And we constantly organize a workshop in this small house on inviting local builders to understand the technique of the construction. But why we are so insisted on this construction? Because Japanese cypress trees on the mountains, and they are actually planted for raising the timbers for construction by village people. But until 80s, people made their own house by themselves, and they use these trees, and they hire the fishermen carpenters and they could make their own house in the community, and then it creates a very beautiful landscape which fits to the nature. But in 90s, house became something to buy for the fishermen, and then it gradually destroys the landscape. And I think that this time, this tsunami really enhanced this tendency. So we really want to bridge these resources which already exist there. And we also have a good carpenter skill, and we have a good typology of the house, but they didn't meet each other until today. So in 90s and 2000, during this decade. So after the earthquake, we should bring back this system to create the sustainable landscape of the fisherman's village. So, yeah. So this construction consume 1.7 times more timber from another normal wooden construction. And all the surface of the building is finished by wood. So also interior space is made of wood and papers. And yeah, it's tiny. It's just 25 square meter for two person. But yeah, there is this kind of cozy space, exterior space. Ah, okay. And so it's so our work is it's not something big, but by working on the even in the small project, if you address to the behavior of the people, behavior of the nature, and behavior of the city building, I think you can anyway intervene into the city fabric and also the people's life and lifestyles. And I call this type of work is anecdotal approach, so it's small thing, but it's very well structuralized in the whole. So if you shift a little bit in the small part, and then as a big part can also start transform. And so I, yeah, so it is the end of my lecture. Thank you very much.
You mentioned earlier about the forest where they cut down the trees every 20 years. Could you tell us a little bit more about that and why they do it?
Tree? Ah, okay. If you leave the tree without this maintenance, the woods becomes too dark, and then the vegetation the type of vegetation start to change, and then it becomes more and more how to say the it's replaced by the trees which doesn't fall the leaves. How do you call this? Is evergreen tree? Yeah, evergreen tree in certain area of Japan. Of course, in the northern, more northern area, this evergreen leaves doesn't grow. So, but yeah, this is the way to keep the forest with falling leaves trees. And then these falling leaves trees was utilized for the fertilizer of the farm in the past by farmers. So it was part of the life of the farming production. And then farmer maintained very well the surface, ground surface of the wood and also the branches. So this operation could keep the wood very transparent as a space. So it could invite people to go in to crop the mushrooms and some wild vegetables, etc., etc. But if it's abandoned for a while, it becomes very dark, and even this falling leaf tree goes too high, and then grow too high, and then people feel a little bit scary to go inside. So this is why they need this operation.
Thanks. Hello.
Hello.
This is loud. I'm wondering if, first of all, if you've been in Montreal long enough to observe any, you talked about behavior of buildings, of city. I'm wondering if you could say a few words about maybe what you saw so far in Montreal and your thoughts on that.
Oh, city of Montreal? Yeah, I think in every city there you can see the different generation of the building but the same typology. And I'm interested in for example, the underground city. We can recognize different generations in the underground city, for example, or housing typology. And this idea of behavior of the building in the longer time scale bring the idea of genealogy of a certain typology. And I'm always try to see the existing typology with this idea of genealogy, bring typology into the state of practice. So typology was thought long time, it was thought just the past, but it's a very stereotypical, if it's called stereotype, it's present. But I think if you really bring them into the state of practice, it could be a kind of, I don't know how to say in English, ING, past, present, and?
Future.
Oh, future, no, not the future.
Present continuous.
Present continuous, yes. present continuous. So the way to turn typology into present continuous is, I think it's a quite important strategy for us. And in order to do that, the understanding of to understand typology as intelligence is quite important. And in order to see it as intelligence, behaviorology is quite key concept. It's quite important. Because if you don't see the typology as shape, we don't see the typology as an icon. We don't see it as a kind of outlines. We see it's a kind of as a result of the real practice of the each element of architectural, each architectural element, which deals sometimes with rain, wind, and heat, and people's behavior, etc., etc. So they are all, if you think all these elements with the behavior of different elements, I think you can see all most of architectural element and typology as intelligence. And then all the typology can be very alive and present continuous. And so you can use it to predict the future, for example, or to propose the future. This is what we are doing.
In your townhouses, the spaces are very narrow and is squeezed in between buildings, yet the interior is very well lit naturally. I'm just wondering, when you design, do you keep this in mind, like natural light, and do you design for that? Or?
Yeah, it's also behavior of light. So it's interesting to think about behavior, because you can't change the behavior of light. But you can make a behavioral capacity, the capacity of the behavior of the light, by providing wall, surface, flat surface, or openings, and et cetera, et cetera. And then you can check how the light and wind behave in this space. And this is always interesting, because you can, it's like a vehicle to experience the space from the position of light. So you try to be a kind of light or smoke or wind to experience the space. And so you jump into this vehicle and walking around or flying around in the building. And then you discover another problem or the difficulties. And then you change a little bit and to make it better. So we are always very conscious on the light and wind and heat, these things. That's okay. Yeah, even dust can be the vehicle to experience the space differently from human eyes. So if you imagine the behavior of the dust, and then it is totally different from the behavior of the people. But it can affect on the behavior of the people, because if there are some corner with accumulation of dust, we don't want to reach there. So it limits our capacity. So it's all related. So this is a way to see the space.